At ease, soldiers. Hayman here. Welcome to another Born to Build devlog. Some of you already know me from our Discord, but for those who don't, I'm sort of the pipeline TD slash technical artist for our little studio. I'm working on everything related to our Maya pipeline, studio tools, as well as helping to develop the engine. Mostly map editor related stuff, and of course, the game itself. So today, I want to talk to you about our assets pipeline. What is its purpose and how we're actually using it? Before I start, I think I need to explain some basic terms in 3D rigging. Geometry, a polygonal object in the scene. Skin or skin cluster deformer. Unlike video game skins you're accustomed to, in this case, it refers to the deformer that allows the skeleton to move the geometry. Joint or bone are the building blocks of the skeletons. They are objects that influence vertices using the skin cluster deformer. Skeleton, a collection of joints or bones. Controller, a nerve surface object that the animator uses to manipulate the skeleton. And finally, shading refers to the materials that are assigned to the geometries. Now that we got that clear, let's continue. The first step is preparation. When working on a new asset, Orca sends me the finalized model to begin applying some cleanups and optimizations to the model to make it game ready. I start by combining all the separate geometries into a single one, so the engine won't have to read a lot of objects per asset while the game is running. This comes with some limitations that I will go over later in the rigging section. Then I do the same for all materials, combining them into the smallest number possible by dividing the UVs into color sections and creating a texture file. This frees us to use textures when needed and not just flat colors. While this makes the shading process a bit longer and more complicated, it does, however, make our life easier when we need to update assets with a new color palette or anything else. Next is rigging. Before I start to actually rig the model, I first go over the animation reference that Orca collected and try to get better understanding of what are his requirements for each asset. After which I create a guide for all the controller's positions. Now, all that's left is to skin the geometry to the skeleton and create whatever custom switches are needed. Remember the limitations I previously mentioned? This is where I need to solve them. When I need to hide a part of an asset, like the bullets or clip, I can't use just the object's visibility as they are now one object. So instead, I set the scale of the part I need to zero. This way, I get the same effect as hiding the object itself. It's easier for the engine to load as it's just part of the animation and won't require any special trigger like toggle visibility. And that's basically the entire process for static assets. For animation, we simply reference the final rigged assets, and from here it's on to Orca for animations. It's pretty much a normal animation studio workflow. It helps us manage the amount of content we want to create for the game by making it easier to update and swap assets even after they've been animated. Because each of us have multiple roles to fill, it's crucial to keep the amount of ping pong between different sections of the pipeline. Up until now, most of the process was very similar to a standard animation studio with slight differences here and there. But now we need to convert all these Maya files into something that the engine can actually use. To achieve this, I've written a lot of automated tools that run over the assets in Maya scenes to handle the export process, while I'm also working on the studio pipeline. Start by exporting the final version of an asset to an FBX file. It contains the skeleton and materials connected to the geometry. This is what I define as a static asset in the pipeline. But you have to remember that the animation clips are also assets in the game. For this, I need to bake the animation keys to the asset skeletons, which I then split export into separate FBX files. These files contain only the animated skeletons without geometry or materials. I define these as animated assets. Now it's time to connect everything in the game engine. This part isn't fully implemented yet, but we already have a pretty solid idea on how it's going to work. The animated FBX that holds the animated skeleton will control the parallel skeleton from the static FBX of the same asset. In this way, we save a lot of disk space and it helps us update small changes when needed, instead of re-exporting an entire animation file all over again. And that's pretty much it. Once we have the assets working in the engine, I'll make another devlog to go over this process.
Thank you for following us, and have a nice ride back to base.
Don't forget to comment and reach out to us on Discord with any questions.
Red smoke on it. Where the hell are you at? I'm right behind you. Roger that.